He's a fellow of the Royal College of Physicians of London.
What are the, how do you classify psychosis in epilepsy? It's classified as ictal. Remember, we talked about this in depression. So psychotic features can arise as an ictal phenomenon, as a manifestation of the seizure itself. They go crazy with the seizure, so to speak, right? It can be a post-ictal psychosis. All of us, many of us, I'm sure all of us have seen that phenomenon. A parictal phenomenon is actually something like a post-ictal thing, but it's commonly seen in a setting where you're withdrawing or changing treatments, and the patient has an increase in their seizure frequency. And associated with that increase in seizure frequency is a change in their psychiatric behavior, so that they demonstrate increasing psychotic ideation, and in fact often, and sometimes, a formal psychotic state. The phenomenon of alternative psychosis is very, very interesting and relates to that whole tension between psychosis versus epilepsy. A long time in the 50s, Landau described that if you put them on treatment and normalize the EEG, these patients demonstrate increasing psychotic ideation and psychotic features. An alternative is, another way of thinking of it is from a clinical perspective. A patient who previously was having lots of seizures comes to you. You recognize they have epilepsy, let's say, or you recognize that they need a change of drug, and you give them a new drug, and the seizures stop. And then they're seizure-free, and you think, oh my God, I've done a great job here. But then they go completely mad. I don't know how many of you have seen this, but I saw this up to 2 months ago in a 22-year-old woman who had had epilepsy from the age of 2 and was having something like 30 seizures a day and had gone on for 20 years with 30 seizures a day. I saw her, realized what was going on, evaluated her, and changed her medication, and immediately stopped her seizures. Now, you would have thought, no, let me paint the picture. This is a patient who was cognitively significantly impaired, was subjected to all of the restrictive things and stigmatizing that we discussed before, and was therefore compromised, right? And was certainly mentally handicapped, if you like, right? One would have thought that by stopping her seizures, thinking of it as being, if you're having continuous seizures, you're either ictal or post-ictal, pre-ictal, in that ongoing continuum of an epileptic encephalopathy, which obviously would be clouding your consciousness, right? And you turn that off. All of a sudden, they should do well. They should be bright and cheery, right? And should be thanking you. Well, it wasn't the case. The family were enraged because she was totally psychotic. And she was basically going nuts, right? And aggressive, she was doing everything that you didn't want her to do, but she was having no seizures. So first of all, my first thing was, have we changed her from overt seizures to subclinical convulsive, non-convulsive status epilepticus? Did an EEG, and her EEG was beautifully normal. I mean, it was exactly the opposite of what her EEG was, and I realized that this lady was demonstrating an alternative psychosis, right? And so I put her on haloperidol, right? And then tapered her haloperidol over 6 weeks. And this girl is now very manageable. She's totally, she's still mentally, you can't change that aspect of it. But she's a transformed person. She's the family. She's helping in the home. She's just there. And she's fine, And she's taking her one anti-seizure drug. And she's off haloperidol. So that's an example, and I spent a lot of time talking about that because I think it's an interesting concept. The biggest issue, though, is interictal psychosis. The patient with epilepsy who has a background psychiatric disorder. 20% of patients with psychosis and epilepsy have this pattern. It is more significant because it's obviously an ongoing chronic process. These patients are different than processed schizophrenia in that they seem to demonstrate a warmer affect and have a higher frequency of delusions and religious mystical experiences. I don't know how many of you look after patients with epilepsy regularly, but many of them are, I wouldn't want to say hyper-religious, but have a very strong religious belief. Now, this may be a reaction to having a very troubling medical disorder itself, but it's more than that. There are the disease itself signifies something to them. Very often, they relate that to you, and I find it a very, very interesting area that needs a lot more study in our local environment. Now, negative symptoms are relatively rare. Visual hallucinations are far more prominent than auditory, which again is an important clue. Neuroleptics in general are less often needed on a chronic basis. And overall, the prognosis seems better than in process schizophrenia. Again, I'm not qualified to speak about treatment of psychosis, but I say that and I take it back at the same time, because I believe that that one of the big issues when you manage patients with epilepsy is that fear of managing these patients and their associated psychiatric disorders. And that leads to inadequate management very often. Sometimes it's a lack of knowledge of the psychiatric co-associations by the neurologist, or it's a lack of knowledge of epilepsy by the psychiatrist, or it's a lack of knowledge of both aspects by the physician, and ultimately a nihilistic philosophy in regard to treating these patients. In other words, they get less treatment than they deserve, right? And I think it's really important to know that we need to treat this aspect of their condition properly, and that these two aspects of their conditions, the physical and the psychiatric, cannot be dissociated. Epilepsy is one of those conditions that sits in what we call the borderland of neurology and psychiatry, and therefore you cannot separate the two. These are the kind of things that you have to go through in the thought process towards treatment, and each of these could take a talk. The third of the five aspects of psychiatric syndromes relates to drug treatment, anti-epileptic drug treatment. And the mechanisms of psychiatric or psychopathology relate obviously to drug toxicity, using more than one drug, and to the concept of forced normalization that I discussed in detail before. And if we look at specific drugs, and that's why I was asking Peter who are the sponsors, because one has to say certain things to them that don't relate. Topamax is, at Columbia when I was in training, was also known as a Dopamax, right? Because it suppressed patients' affect and in a way dumbed them up when it was used at too high doses. Now, in the 10 years ago, it was recommended that for epilepsy, Topamax should be given at a dose of 200 milligrams BD. But that was associated with significant cognitive effects. And now it has been recognized that effective anti-seizure therapeutic efficacy can be attained at 50 milligrams twice a day without the associated cognitive impairments that were seen before. Now, listed, phenytoin at high doses can produce a schizophrenic form-like illness. We all know barbiturates can have strange behavioral effects and, of course, depression in adults. Ethosuximide produced, as I mentioned before, the issue of forced normalization in patients with primary generalized epilepsies. Carbamazepine can produce depression, but rarely mania, and as you know too, it can be used to treat these things, right? And it's always a very individual thing. Every one of us will respond differently. If we give all of us in this room the same drug, you cannot anticipate that all of us will have the same response to it. Valproate is a very interesting drug in terms of producing encephalopathy. And in fact, very recently, 3 months ago, I was asked to see a lady who proved to have, let me paint the picture, primary generalized epilepsy with chronic renal failure, getting dialysis, but having rare seizures. The seizures were thought to be due to chronic renal failure, metabolic thing. But she was evaluated, we evaluated her and realized that she had a primary generalized epilepsy, an epilepsy syndrome that could have presented in adolescence but presented at the age of 60, meaning her threshold was changed by developing chronic renal failure and her seizures now manifesting themselves. So she was tried on one drug and had a bad drug reaction to it, tried on another drug and had was unable to tolerate it and was put on valproate by me, and did really well. Seizures stopped, everything was fine. And then progressively over 3 months, this lady started to become what you would almost regard as formally demented. And her nephrologist was saying to me, I don't know what's going on here. Her dialysis factors or parameters are fine. Why is this happening? So I saw her, and formally she looked like a classic relatively early onset Alzheimer's. And this was really troubling to all of us. And then something said to me, could this in fact be a valproate-related encephalopathy? And could she be hyperammonemic? And you know, you can't get ammonia levels in Jamaica. And we had to send away her ammonia levels to Miami. And her ammonia levels were 15 times normal. And it was due to carnitine deficiency. And we had to reverse her valproate and change it to yet another drug, a fourth drug, and add carnitine. And this lady came right back to her normal baseline. So, drugs are not innocuous. As we know too, though, that many of them can have positive effects on these other